بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد، all praise due to Allah سبحانه وتعالى and peace be upon Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. I testify that there is no God except Allah, and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. Brothers and sisters, here we are once again. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us to be in a gathering like this gathering, a gathering of knowledge, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most knowledgeable man, alayhi salatu wa salam, to seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessing and to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase his knowledge. وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِ عِلْمًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to ask Allah azza wa jal to increase his knowledge. That's the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he is the most knowledgeable man when it comes to Islam. So what about us? For us, we need to constantly ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our knowledge, and not only ask Allah azza wa jalla to increase our knowledge, but also put the effort, put the time and effort for us to seek knowledge. Because every single one of us wants to increase their knowledge in Islam, but the problem is putting the time and effort. And it is sometimes for some people it is a burden, but for other people it is a joy. Some people enjoy seeking knowledge, and other people feel like it's a burden. It's like that force, like the salah. Some people pray the salah because they are obliged to pray, which they are. It is obligatory upon you and mandatory that you pray. And other people pray the prayer because they enjoy it, like the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, وَجُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ, and my heart is so attached to the salah. Then when he alayhi salatu wasalam used to stress, what did he used to do alayhi salatu wasalam? He used to go and pray. When we stress, we stop praying. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, when he used to feel pressure or when he used to feel stress, alayhi salatu wasalam used to resort to the salah. And there's a famous saying of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, in which the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam will call upon Bilal, the adhan caller, arihna biha ya Bilal. Oh Bilal, comfort us. Comfort us in which way? Call for the salah. When is it time for the salah? Call for the salah so we could relax. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to pray the prayers because he used to enjoy it. He used to relax. Some people pray the prayers because they're obliged to and they feel that burden upon them. And same goes to seeking knowledge. Some people seek knowledge and they enjoy it. And other people seek knowledge because they feel like they have to. It's like a must on them. We want to reach to that level and state that we seek knowledge because we enjoy it. We enjoy to sit in gatherings like these gatherings. We enjoy to hear the words of Allah Azza wa Jal and the words of the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We enjoy to know about our religion. We enjoy to understand our deen better. And that's what we need to aim for. For that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala commanded the Prophet Alayhi Salatu Wasallam, the most knowledgeable man, if not in everything, at least in Islam, at least in the Quran, at least in the Sunnah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنَ عِلْمًا. O Muhammad, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase your knowledge. Constantly ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase your knowledge. And Thursday night lessons here at the UMA is specified or is organized for the sake of seeking knowledge. So Thursday nights, every Thursday nights when we get together here at the UMA Center, we particularly focus on seeking knowledge. How can we increase our knowledge in Islam? How can I understand my deen better? Because when I understand my deen better, then I get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then not only I get closer to Allah azza wa jal, but I also get closer to my religion. Obviously, when you get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you get closer to your religion. But when you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better and you know exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from you, then you get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A lot of us love Allah, but they don't even know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from him. Why? Because they are unknowledgeable people. They don't know much about Islam. They don't know much what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them. For that, my brothers and my sisters, it must be an objective in our lives that we want to seek knowledge. Every single week, we want to take a step closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jal also says in the Quran Kareem, يَرْفَعُ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمُ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevates those who believe from amongst you and those who seek knowledge. So when you seek knowledge, you get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You get elevated to Allah Azza wa Jal. Now, right now, this 1 hour or 45 minutes or even half an hour of knowledge, you're going to feel yourself closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm sure you feel that every time you sit in a gathering of knowledge. Every time you attend a gathering of knowledge, or every time you attend a class that teaches you about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or Islam, you feel like after that class that you just got closer to Allah azza wa jal. Subhanallah. يَرْفَعَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevates those who believe from amongst you and those who seek knowledge. Tonight's topic, inshallah, it is the 51st chapter of the book of Riyad al-Salihin. And tonight, inshallah, we shall talk about Bab al-Raja, hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. Hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy, which is very important. Why? This chapter is connected to the previous chapter. What was last week's chapter? Fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fearing Allah azza wa jalla. And we spoke about that in two different nights. So we spoke about it in two different parts. For 2 weeks we spoke about fearing Allah azza wa jal. Tonight, inshallah, and next week we're going to talk about having hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's the way of life of a believer. We live in between two wings. One wing that we fear Allah azza wa jal, the other wing that we have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rahmah. Some people live with one wing, with one element in their life. All they do is have hope in Allah azza wa jal in his rahmah, and they have no fear of Allah azza wa jal, and that's why they always disobey Allah azza wa jal and constantly disobey Allah Almighty. And other people only fear Allah azza wa jal and have no hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rahmah, as if they're just going to the hellfire. That's it. No, as a true believer, I live between those two wings. My life revolves around those two elements. Fearing Allah Azza wa Jal and hopes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. I fear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish me. I have hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive me. These are the two wings that we live by. We live with those two wings. I fear Allah Azza wa Jal that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish me. At the same time, I have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that will have mercy upon me. Allah will forgive me and have mercy upon me. I fear the punishment of Allah Azza wa Jal in hellfire. At the same time, I've got hope that inshallah I'll enter the Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in this verse, which is an amazing verse in Surah Az-Zumar. Allah says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Verse 53 in Surah Az-Zumar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling upon who? In the Quran Kareem, you realize the style of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when Allah addresses a specific type of people or a category of people. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses people in general. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes he calls upon Ya ayyuhan nas, people in general, Muslims, non-Muslims, believers, disbelievers, obedient or disobedient. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls upon the believers, Ya ayyuhal mu'minun, or those who believe. But this verse in particular, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling upon his disobedient servants. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Subhanallah. And I want you to pay attention here to the style of addressing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed the disobedient servants. So right now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this surah, in this verse, Surah Az-Zumar, verse 53, Allah is calling upon who? Allah is not calling upon people in general. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not calling upon the believers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling upon the disobedient Muslims, even though they are believers. But here specifically Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling upon the disobedient Muslims. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala call them with first? Allah called them ibadi, my servants. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not disconnect that slavery connection between his servants and him. So the first thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ, all my servants. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes what kind of a servant is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calling upon? Which category of his servants? What type of people is Allah calling upon? الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Those who transgressed against themselves. Those who are committing the sins. Those who are disobeying me. Those who are neglecting me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling upon his disobedient servants. And the first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls upon them, he calls them, you are my servant. Whether you like it or not, you are the servant of Allah azza wa jal. Whether you acknowledge it or not, you are the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether you accept it or not, you are the servant of Allah azza wa jal. But look at the style of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the rahmah of Allah. And you could sense Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy and forgiveness in this verse when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling upon the disobedient servants. What did Allah say? Ibadi. Number one, you are my servants. but you're a disobedient servant. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't start off with my disobedient servants. Allah started it with my servants who are disobedient. My servants who are disobedient. When you think about it, there's a big difference when someone, like for example your father, when he starts to tell you, you're a naughty person, you're a bad person, you're this, you're that, or when he says, son, come here, you are wrong. Subhanallah. There's that affection. There's that mercy. There's that compassion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most compassionate, and Allah azza wa jal is the most merciful. For that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling upon his disobedient servants, and Allah says, all my servants who disobey me. What's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying to them? So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala captivated their attention. If you're a disobedient servant to Allah azza wa jal, in which the vast majority of us are disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but some of us on different levels, some of us disobey Allah azza wa jal very minimal, others have no boundaries. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling upon those who transgressed against themselves. They went beyond the boundaries, they crossed the lines, they just continue disobeying Allah azza wa jal. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling upon those people, all my servants, those who disobey me. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to send to them? What message is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala trying? Or Allah azza wa jal, forget about the word trying. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to send to them. The message that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to send to them, لا تقنطوا من رحمة الله. الله أكبر. Do not break your hopes from the mercy of Allah. Don't despair from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't be despondent. Don't break your hopes from the mercy of Allah azza wa jal. Even though you are disobeying Allah azza wa jal, even though you are neglecting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's commands in your life, even though you are committing the sins, Allah azza wa jal is calling upon you and he's saying to you, oh my servant, the one who is disobeying me, the one who's not praying, the one that's not fasting, the one that's committing the haram, that's the one that's indulging in the sins, don't break your hopes from my mercy. Don't break your hopes. Even though you are a sinner, even though you've sinned, even though you've committed so many sins, even though you've been committing so many evil actions, even though you've neglected me, even though you had forgotten me, even though you've committed this and that, even though you've done what I told you not to do and you did not do what I told you to do, don't break your hopes from my mercy. Don't be despondent. Don't be despaired from my mercy. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Inna Allaha yaghfiru dhunuba jami'a. Allah will indeed forgive all the sins, regardless what sin it is. But don't break your hopes from Allah azza wa jal. Someone might say, I'm a sinner, I've been committing all sorts of sins. I do this, I do that, and I do this, and I do that. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing you right now. And he's saying to you, oh my servant, don't break your hopes from my mercy. Allah will forgive. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised in this verse and other similar verses like this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised that he'll forgive any sin. Inna Allah yaghfiru dhunuba jami'a, innahu huwa al-ghafur rahim. He is the one that attributed to himself the most merciful and the most forgiving. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us in this verse, do not break your hopes from the mercy of Allah, regardless who you are and what you had committed. Regardless what sin you had committed, don't break your hopes from the mercy of Allah. Allah will forgive. Even if it's a big, massive sin, even if it's a big, massive sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive. But at the same time, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is shadid al-iqab. Remember when we spoke about that last week? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful, but at the same time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he punishes severely. So we live with two wings, hope in the mercy of Allah, fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's punishment. The other verse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ, and my mercy had encompassed everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy will include everyone and everything. But ask for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy. Seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy and Allah azza wa jalla have mercy upon you. Seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive you. But never break your hopes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to you, And look at the amazing addressing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he's addressing here. He's not saying, oh my believers, oh my obedient servants, all those who pray and those who fast and those who never disobey me. Allah is calling upon those that disobey him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not even disconnect from you. What do you disconnect from him? When you're a sinner and you're a disobedient servant of Allah azza wa jal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your Lord and he did not even disconnect from you. Why do you disconnect from him? It should be the other way around. Allah is the one that should be disconnecting from you because he's your Lord. He's your creator. He's your master. He's your maker. He's your provider. He's your sustainer. He's the one that controls you. And you've disobeyed him. He should be disconnecting from you. But even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not even disconnect from you, you are the one that's disobeying him. You are the one that's neglecting him. You are the one that's indulging in the sins. You are the one that's committing the haram. You are the one that's doing things that Allah Azza wa Jalla told you not to do. You are the one that's not doing things that Allah Azza wa Jalla told you to do. At the end of the day, Allah tells you, okay, don't break your hopes for my mercy. I'll forgive you. But come to me. Seek my forgiveness. But don't break your hopes for my mercy. Some people break their hopes from the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. Oh, you know what? I've done this and I've done that. And I've done everything. Everything under the sun I've committed. I've committed all sorts of haram. You don't know who I used to be. I used to be this person. I used to be that person. Well, Allah Azza wa Jal is calling upon people like you. And Allah is saying to you, don't break your hopes from mercy. Don't be despondent. Have hopes. Have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rahmah. Have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's forgiveness and Allah azza wa jalla will forgive. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in this first hadith that Imam al-Nawawi compiled in this chapter, وَعَنْ عُبَادَةَ بْنِ الصَّامِتْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ شَهِدَ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وأن عيسى عبد الله ورسوله وكلمته ألقاها إلى مريم وروح منه وأن الجنة حق والنار حق أدخله الله الجنة على ما كان من العمل. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in this hadith that's been narrated by Ubadah ibn Samit radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, in which he says, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in this famous hadith that whoever bear witnesses and testifies that there's no God except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Muhammad is the prophet and the messenger of Allah, and Isa, Jesus, is the servant and the prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the word of Allah azza wa jalla was communicated to Maryam alayha salam, and the Jannah, the paradise, is true, and the hellfire is true, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will admit him into the Jannah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect him and preserve him from the hellfire regardless what he had done. Regardless what he had done. Now, we read this hadith. And alhamdulillah, a lot of Muslims become very happy when they hear this hadith. They say, alhamdulillah, I believe Allah. I believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I believe in Allah azza wa jalla. I believe in the oneness of Allah. I don't believe in any other deity than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I believe that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the prophet and the messenger of Allah. I believe in the prophecy of Isa alayhi salam. I believe that the Jannah is true. I believe that the hellfire is true. Alhamdulillah. From this hadith, I'm guaranteed Jannah. No, it's not guaranteed Jannah. But with that iman, if you really believe in Allah Azza wa Jalla, believe in the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, believe in Isa Alayhi Salam, and believe in the hellfire, and believe in the paradise, you'll obey Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. That's what it means. Because the following hadith here, it comes where Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says that the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam once called upon him and he said, Ya Mu'adh, O Mu'adh. So Mu'adh said, Labbayka Ya Rasulallah wa Sa'daik, O Messenger of Allah, here I am, very attentive and I'm listening. So the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam again, he calls for the attention of Mu'adh and he says to him, O Mu'adh. So Mu'adh says, O Messenger of Allah, here I am, I'm listening, I am attentive, tell me what you want. And again the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam tells him, Ya Mu'adh. And Mu'adh says, Labbayka Ya Rasulallah wa Sa'daik. Why did the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam repeat it three times, calling for Mu'adh, calling for the attention of Mu'adh, to tell Mu'adh the importance of what the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is about to say to him? When I say to you, Muhammad, you say to me, what? Say to you, Muhammad, what? Muhammad, what? It means like what I'm going to about to say to you is very serious. What I'm about to say to you is something that you need to pay a lot of attention to. So when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam called Mu'adh the first time, Mu'adh said, "Yes, O Messenger of Allah." Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam calls upon Mu'adh the second time, and Mu'adh says, "Yes, O Messenger of Allah." Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam calls upon Mu'adh the third time, and the Mu'adh says, "Yes, O Messenger of Allah." So now Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam wants to tell him what he alayhi salatu wasalam had planned to tell him. مَا مِنْ عَبْدٍ يَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَأَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ صِدْقًا مِنْ قَلْبِهِ إِلَّا حَرَّمَهُ اللَّهُ عَلَى النَّارِ. So now Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling him the important message. What's the important message here? He says to him, "O Mu'adh, anyone who testifies that there's no God except Allah and Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah sincerely from his heart, with full conviction from his heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect him from the hellfire." So now what does Mu'adh say? I want you to listen now. Mu'adh replies back to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and says to him, "Oh Messenger of Allah, that's a beautiful news. That's good news. Should I convey it to other people? Should I relate it to other people? Should I tell other people?" So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "No, otherwise people will only depend on this." People will start depending on this hadith. Pray. The Prophet said, "If I say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, sincerely from my heart, I'm going to enter the Jannah. That's it. There's no hellfire for me. I don't need to pray. Fast. I don't need to fast because the Prophet Muhammad said, whoever says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan abduhu Rasulullah, sincerely from his heart, will enter the Jannah. Stop the haram. Well, I'll say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasulah." And the Prophet says, anyone that says those two kalima, those two words, sincerely from their hearts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect him from the hellfire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will admit him to the Jannah. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "No, don't convey that to other people. Otherwise people start depending on this hadith. And they will misunderstand this hadith. Not only people will depend on this hadith, but people will start misunderstanding this hadith. They'll think, khalas, ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu an Muhammad Rasulullah. Take drugs, drink alcohol, commit fornication and adultery, do this and do that. Alhamdulillah, I'm a Muslim." And how many times you see Muslims like that? "Ana imani bil alb. Iman is in my heart. Ya akhi, pray. Iman is in my heart. Fast. Iman is in my heart. Keep away from the haram. Iman is in my heart." What's iman? What kind of iman are you talking about here? What kind of iman that you have in your heart that you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the same time? If you really had that sincere and pure iman in your heart, your iman will stop you from disobeying Allah Azza wa Jal. And your iman will push you and encourage you to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what kind of iman are you talking about here? What kind of a belief do you have in your heart? Wallah, ana iman bi albi. How many times you come across, especially Arabs, and I'm sorry to say this, especially, ana mu'min bil alb. Ushu, bayi, alli, isro, uzni, wa'tol, wa'amil, wa'amil, bas matkazib. MashaAllah. My father taught me, commit murder, steal, fornicate, do whatever you want to do, but don't ever lie. Wallah, your father needs to be disciplined before you. Abuk biddu tirbaya ablak. Your father needs to be disciplined before you. How many times do you hear that? And people pride themselves, people boast about, my father taught me this. He taught me, fornicate, commit adultery, steal, do this, do that, but never lie. Sure, what kind of a father is that? Your father, it looks like your father needs a lot more discipline than you. That's the wrong understanding of the Sharia. That's the wrong understanding of this hadith and the previous hadith. If you really have iman in your heart, a sincere iman in your heart, this iman will stop you and prevent you from disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This iman will encourage you and push you always to obey Allah azza wa jal. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, "Ma min abdin yashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu sidqan min qalbi." Look at the condition that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam stipulates in this hadith. Sincerely from his heart, with full conviction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only Lord and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. And when you say that with full conviction from your heart, with full sincerity, that means you know that you must obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you believe in Allah Azza wa Jal, that means you have to surrender to Him. What kind of a surrender is that? What kind of a belief is that? That I believe in Allah Azza wa Jal, but I disobey Him. I believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but I disobey Him. I believe in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah and the greatest example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent. The greatest man that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made to step on the face of this earth. I know that this is Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's the man that I should be following. He's the man that I should be following his footsteps. I don't even follow him. What kind of an iman is that? What kind of an iman is that? That's a worthless iman in your heart. That's a worthless iman. What kind of an iman do you have? That you believe in Allah and you disobey him. You believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you don't even follow him. What iman is that? What iman are you banking on in the hereafter that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to save you from the hellfire? And Allah azza wa jalla will. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. But as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, then depend on that. Depend on your good deeds. As the previous hadith that we mentioned last week, what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, that every single one of us shall stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. Every single one of you will be standing before Allah azza wa jal hereafter. No intermediary in between them and Allah azza wa jal. No interpreter between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah azza wa jal will bring them forward. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, you will look towards your right, you only find your deeds. You look towards your left, you only find your deeds. And then you look before you, you find the hellfire. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, اتقوا النار ولا بشق التمرة اتقوا النار ولا بشق التمرة. Protect yourself, prevent yourselves from the hellfire, even though you need to donate half a day. سنا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, in this hadith he's saying to you, even though you've got iman, even though you believe in Allah and you believe in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you're not going to initiate something, if you're not going to do something in your life, if you're not going to practice what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had commanded you to practice, if you're not going to uphold Islam in your life, then in the hereafter you're going to look towards your right and left and in front of you and you're going to find the hellfire. So my brothers and my sisters, it's so important for us to understand the deen. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, anyone who believes in Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only Lord, and believes in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah, believes in Isa alayhi salam as the Prophet and the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and believes that the paradise is there, and believes what? That the hellfire is there. You believe that the paradise is there and the hellfire is there. If you reach to that level, that you have 100% conviction that the paradise is there and the hellfire is there, you will never ever dare to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a reality. That's the truth. If we have 100% iman, belief, and conviction that the paradise is there and the hellfire is there, we'll never disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we work, why do we work? Who gets paid before they do their work? You always get paid after you do your work. So you work so hard. You sweat your head off and you work so hard. And you've put all the hard yakka and you put all the hard effort, but then at the end of the day, you get rewarded. What made you work so hard? Because you believe in that reward. But you didn't see that reward at the beginning or while you're working. You saw it after you finished that work. Same thing. The paradise is there. You're not going to get it before you work for it. You're not going to get it before you strive for it. So if you really believe in the Jannah, and you believe the Jannah is your reward, and you believe that's the ultimate reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you at the end, then you'll work hard for it. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, وَأَنَّ الْجَنَّةَ حَقٌّ وَالنَّارَ حَقٌّ. You believe that the paradise is true and the hellfire is true. Now all of us say, of course I believe in Allah. Of course I believe in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Of course I believe in the Jannah. Of course I believe in the hellfire. If you believe in Allah azza wa jal, and you believe in the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you believe that the Jannah is there, and you believe that the hellfire is there, and you believe the Jannah is the ultimate reward for the believers who obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they'll be admitted into it. And you believe that the hellfire will be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's severe punishment for those who disobey him, then why you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why do you continue disobeying Allah Azza wa Jalla? It just doesn't even make sense. It doesn't make sense. For that, my brothers and my sisters, let's not misunderstand this hadith. Let's not misunderstand what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in these hadith. Yes, your key to the Jannah is La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. But for you to put that key in the door, you need to make that movement, and that movement is your actions. That strength for you to open that door is your actions, your deeds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful. He gives a lot for the little that you do. Allah gives a lot for the little that you do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us the Jannah, not because of our good deeds. What's our good deeds compared to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us to in the Jannah? We work so hard in our lives, 20, 30 years, 8 to 10, even 12 hours a day for us to acquire a house or a duplex. Alhamdulillah, I made a big achievement. 40, 50, 60 hours of our life every single week, we work so hard to acquire $1,000 or $2,000. And now we want to enter the Jannah. That the last person that enters the Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him 10 times as big as this world. 10 times as big as this world. We want to enter the Jannah and we want to be from the people of the Jannah just by doing few minutes here and there. Every here and there, like in a minute here and a minute there. And then I want Allah to give me the Jannah. And Allah will. Allah will. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you the Jannah, not because of the good deeds or the volume of the good deeds that you've done. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you the Jannah because of the rahmah that He had given you. The rahmah that He had bestowed upon you. Because if you want to compare, if you want to calculate your good deeds in return of the Jannah, you'll be lucky to get a grass, one grass or one seed of sand in the Jannah. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, لَمَوْضِعُ صَوْتٍ فِي الْجَنَّةِ خَيْرٌ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا فِيهَا. Placing a stick in the Jannah, and the stick, the place that the staff or the stick occupies in the Jannah. So how big is that? You know what? Let's say one meter square. Even though it's a lot less than that. But the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that the place or the ground that a stick occupies in the Jannah, it's better than this whole world and what's in it. This is the Jannah. You want to enter the Jannah based on what? Ya Allah, I said, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Okay, alhamdulillah. And what? Prove it. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, whoever says, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, sincerely from their heart, with full conviction, and believes in the Jannah and believes in the hellfire. So where's your belief in the Jannah? And where's your belief in the hellfire? Those who are banking on this, because you've got a lot of people who are banking on this. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says to Mu'adh, don't convey it to others. Don't spread it. Otherwise people start depending on it. People start banking on it. They think, khalas, alhamdulillah, I don't need to pray anymore. I don't need to fast anymore. I don't need to read the Quran Kareem. I don't need to pay zakat. I don't need to go to hajj. I could do this haram and I could do that haram and I could commit this sin and I could go and do that thing. Because alhamdulillah, I say, la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. No, sincerely, for the sake of Allah. From the deep bottom of your heart. From the deep bottom of your heart, you are so sincere about it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept it from you. The next hadith, which is another amazing hadith that tells us, it tells us about the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal and the generosity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And listen to this amazing hadith. And this is a hadith Qudsi. There's two types of a hadith. There's two types of reports or prophetic traditions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One in which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says it without saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. The other one in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks on behalf of Allah azza wa jal with his own words. With the own words of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So this is a hadith al-Qudsi in which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Allah says. But that's not Quran, because the Quran, the wording and the meaning is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith, the wording is from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but the meaning is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In this amazing hadith al-Qudsi, in which it tells us and it paints to us the greatness of Allah Azza wa Jal and His generosity, His mercy and forgiveness. يَقُولُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلْ مَنْ جَاءَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ فَلَهُ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا أَوْ أَزِيدُ وَمَنْ جَاءَ بِالسَّيِّئَةِ فَجَزَاءُ سَيِّئَةً مِثْلَهَا أَوْ أَغْفِرُ وَمَنْ تَقَرَّبَ مِنِّي شِبْرًا تَقَرَّبْتُ مِنْهُ ذِرَاعًا وَمَنْ تَقَرَّبَ مِنِّي ذِرَاعًا تَقَرَّبْتُ مِنْهُ بَاعًا وَمَنْ أَتَانِي يَمْشِي أَتَيْتُهُ هَرْوَلًا وَمَنْ لَقِيَنِي بِقُرَابِ الْأَرْضِ خَطَايَا لَا يُشْرِكُ بِي شَيْئًا لَقِيتُهُ بِمِثْلِهَا مَغْفِرَةً. الله أكبر. This is a hadith that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam makes mention of the greatness of the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His generosity. How forgiving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, how merciful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, how generous Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. He says, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah says, what does Allah say? Any of my servants that do a good deed, you've established a good deed, small or big, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, I'll straight away multiply it up to 10 times, in another hadith up to 700 times. You offer one good deed, straight away, automatically, by default, will be multiplied to 10 times, up to 700 times. Not wallahi, double time and a half, three times, four times, 10 times, up to 700 times. You do one good deed, straight away, 10 times. Allah doesn't give one hasana. It's always 10 and over. Always 10 and over. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says another hadith, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will continue to multiply it and multiply it up to 700 times, even more than that. You do one good deed, one simple good deed, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will just increase from the hasanat. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam continues to say, and whoever commits a sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will only record it as a sin, one sin. Look at the head start that Allah always gives you. So you do one good deed, 10 times, up to 700 times. You do one bad deed, only one bad deed. That's it. It gets recorded once a year. One bad deed. You do one good deed, 10 times, up to 700 times. At the same time you do one bad deed, you only get once a year. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you this immense head start. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you this head start with your good deeds over your bad deeds. So you do one good deed, up to 700 times. One bad deed, one bad deed. In another hadith, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam even says that if my servant thinks of doing a good deed and he does not end up doing it, I'll record it for him as a good deed. So you think, you know, you're sitting down, you say, you know what, inshallah, I want to give something for the sake of Allah. I want to donate. He thought about it. I want to give $10 for the sake of Allah. And then before you walked away, you forgot, or you said, you know what, don't worry about it. Allah will give you a reward. We'll give you a hasanah. Not as much as the hasanat that when you do it, but because of that good initiative that you initiated in your heart, because of that good gesture in your heart, even that something between you and Allah Azza wa Jal, you intended to do something good, but you didn't end up doing it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you for it. Then the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, and if my servant intends to do a bad deed, to commit a sin, and he does not end up doing it, I'll give him a hasana. Allahu Akbar. You know what? You call your boss tomorrow, tell him, look, I wanted to come to work, but you know, because of my intention, can you please pay me? I'm not coming, but you know, just for my intention. He's going to tell you, you know what? Just stay at home and then come back again. I'm going to send you a nice boot. Imagine. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you. Because you made an intention, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards you. Just because you made an intention, he didn't even do anything. No practice. Nothing has been executed. But because you had that good intention that, ya Allah, I intend to do good, Allah rewards you. And then you end up intending to do something bad, but you don't end up doing it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also rewards you. Subhanallah, when you really think about it, Allah has given us a head start, like so big, that sometimes when I think about it, you have to be so vile, you have to be so evil for you to end up in the hellfire. Because every good deed that you do, 700 times, up to 1,000 times. Every bad deed that you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only records it one bad deed. You think of doing one, you don't end up doing it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you a hasanah. Not only that, but the more hasanat that you do, the more of those hasanat will start wiping and deleting your sayyat. Subhanallah, amazing. Amazing, amazing. Then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, and if my servant gets closer to me, one hand span, I'll get closer to him, two hand spans. You get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, 1 meter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets closer to you, 2 meters. You get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, two hand spans, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gets closer to you, 4 hand spans. Subhanallah, Allah the Rabb, Allah the King, Allah the Master and the Creator, Allah the Sustainer and Provider, Allah the Maker, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who is the beginner, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the first and he is the last. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of the universe. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that says, kun fayakun, be it happens. He's saying to you, oh my servant, come close to me, one step, I'll come closer to you, two steps. Tomorrow, go and call. Go and call some official, go and call someone with royalty or someone with some highness in this world and say to him, look, there's about 50 kilometers between us. I'll come 20 kilometers and you come 30 kilometers. You'll be lucky to get him on the phone. You'll be lucky to even get any sort of correspondence from them or any reply. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to you, take one step closer to me, I'll come back to you two steps closer to you. Get closer to me one handspan, I'll get closer to you two handspans. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَمَنْ أَتَانِي يَمْشِي أَتَيْتُ هَرْوَلَ. And whoever walks to me, I'll come back to him running. Allahu Akbar. You walk to Allah, Allah will come back to you running. Now when we say getting closer to Allah Azza wa Jal, one handspan and getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one step and getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by walking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is all metaphorically. Metaphorically in which way? With your actions. That's how you get closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. There's no ladder for you to reach to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no suburb for you to get to Allah Azza wa Jal. It's about your actions. The more good deeds that you do, the closer you become to Allah Azza wa Jal. The more you sacrifice for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you become closer to Allah Azza wa Jal. In return, the more Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes closer to you. So when you take one step to Allah, in reality, it's three steps to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In reality, it's three steps. One step to Allah, it's three steps to Allah. That's how close Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be with Him. And then the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, oh my servant, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this hadith, and my servant, if you come to me with this entire world of sins, you come to me and this whole world is full of sins, you come back to me, worshipping me, repenting to me, seeking my forgiveness, knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am your Lord, that I'll forgive you, I'll come back to you in return with this whole world full of mercy. Allahu Akbar. You come back to me, you go back to Allah Azza wa Jal, you return back to Allah, you repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you go to Allah Azza wa Jal with mountains of sins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to you, I'll come back to you with more mountains of mercy. Never break your hopes in Allah. Never be despondent. But my brothers and my sisters, don't take this for granted. Don't take Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rahmah for granted. You are dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of us think that could exploit it and take it for granted. Alhamdulillah, Allah ghafoor rahim, Allah is merciful, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have mercy upon me. Don't take it for granted. You're dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't play games with Allah azza wa jal. If you are sincere about it, you will never ever take it for granted. That's why the righteous believers, the sahaba, the prophets and the messengers, the more they knew that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive them, the more they'll get closer to Allah azza wa jal. And I mentioned the story to you before, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was informed by Allah azza wa jal that Allah had forgiven his sins, the future and the past, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam increased from his praise to Allah. That his wife Aisha will continue to experience and see the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam every single night, praying the night until his legs will swell. Until the legs of the Prophet ﷺ will start shivering. His legs alayhi salatu wasalam will start shivering because of the long standing that the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ is standing during the night. So his wife will say to him, O Messenger of Allah, why do you burden yourself? Why do you bring this hardship upon yourself when Allah had already promised you forgiveness? And Allah not only had forgiven your past sins, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had forgiven your future sins, even though you're a man that does not even sin. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied back and he said, "Idhan afala akunu 'abdan shakura." If that's the case, then shouldn't I be a thankful servant to Allah? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had forgiven me and Allah azza wa jal had informed me that I'm being forgiven and I'm going to be from the people that will enter the Jannah, and the Jannah and the gate of the Jannah will not open to anyone before me, then I should be thankful to Allah. That's what you call sidq. That's what you call truthfulness. In the shahada, when you say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu muhammad rasulullah, that's what you call sincerity. That's the sincerity that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is talking about in this hadith. Whoever says la ilaha illallah muhammad rasulullah sincerely from their hearts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive them. That's the sincerity that we need to have. Not wallahi, Allah ghafur rahim. Yes, Allah ghafur rahim, but Allah shadid al-iqab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also a severe punisher. When he punishes severely.
So don't just look at it from that angle. Look at it from the other angle too. Don't look at it that Allah will forgive your sins. Look at it that Allah will punish you because of your sins. Then depend on it, as the Prophet Muhammad says. Then bank on it. Then bank on it. As a lot of people are banking on it. Alhamdulillah, I'm a Muslim. I'm going to enter the Jannah. My brothers and my sisters, you know how many people I encounter? You know how many people I speak to? When I told them, Ya akhi, fear Allah Azza wa Jalla. Stop the haram that you are committing. Start praying. Keep away from the haram. Keep away from the sins. They say, are we at the end as Muslims going to end up in the Jannah? We might as well. Hey, mashallah alaik. You can't even handle praying to Allah Azza wa Jalla half an hour a day. You're going to handle the punishment of Allah in the hellfire for thousands of years. Wake up to yourself. What kind of a statement is that? How many people told me, are we at the end as Muslims? We're going to end up in the Jannah? Yeah. You're going to end up in the Jannah, yeah? Okay, so alhamdulillah, I'll be free in this world and Allah will forgive me and make me into the Jannah. What world are you talking about? You can't even handle 7 years of minor hardships of you acquiring halal income, of you praying to Allah Azza wa Jal, of you holding your desires. You're going to handle Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's punishment in hellfire for thousands of years? Subhanallah, uncalculated. People are saying things without even thinking about them. So stupid. Wallah, I've experienced so many people. Oh, inshallah, we're going to end up in the Jannah. MashaAllah, you're really banking on something big. Yes, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah is not big, it's the greatest. But like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told you not to do this, you're still doing it. What, just because wallah, your name is Muhammad, you're going to enter the Jannah? Or your name is Aisha or Khadija, you're going to enter the Jannah? No, it's your amal. It's your siddiq before your amal, your sincerity, your purity in your heart. How pure are you? When you say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, are you pure about it? Are you sincere about it? Do you mean it? Because if you mean it, you never disobey Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's a reality of it. If you believe in the Jannah, you believe in the hellfire, you always aim to be from the people of the Jannah. You always do, and whatever it takes for you to prevent yourself from the people of the hellfire, you'll do anything for that. So don't kid yourself. Don't fool yourself. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran al-Kareem, in many verses, we fool ourselves. We deceive our own selves. We lie our own selves. Oh, alhamdulillah, I'm a Muslim. Inshallah, I'm going to end up in the Jannah. End up in the Jannah, mashallah. And not some of them like, you know what? I'll go to the hellfire and then end up in the Jannah, mashallah. I'll go in the hellfire. It's like going to the hellfire, it's like going to National Park. Going for a swim. I'll get to the hellfire and then inshallah I'll get to the Jannah. MashaAllah alaik. Yeah. It's a walk in the park, the hellfire. It's a nice experience for you. Last week we mentioned that the lowest and the smallest punishment in the hellfire is someone that stands on two stands of fire and two coals of fire until his brains boil. That's the smallest punishment in the hellfire. So that's yani, inshallah I'll get to the hellfire and inshallah I'll end up in the Jannah. So easily said, Allahu Akbar. And subhanAllah, pray. That's too hard. To make wudu and pray for 5-6 minutes, that's big. That's too hard. That's too much of a burden. That's a hardship. And going to the hellfire, that's a walk in the park. Subhanallah, how deceiving we are to ourselves. How deceiving we are sometimes to ourselves. We deceive ourselves. We fool ourselves. It shocks me when someone says something like that. That, you know what, I'll get to the hellfire. Then inshallah, as a Muslim, I end up in the paradise. And this person can't even get up to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 5 minutes. That's a burden for him, but the hellfire, it's a joy. Deception, wal-iyadu billah. For that, my brothers and my sisters, have hopes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rahmah. Have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy and forgiveness. And know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving and the most merciful. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Man mata la yushriku billahi shay'an dakhala al-jannah, wa man mata yushriku bihi shay'an dakhala al-nar. A man comes to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tells him, O Messenger of Allah, give me the principles of Islam. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, whoever dies believing in no one but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will enter the Jannah. And whoever dies believing in someone beside Allah azza wa jalla will enter the hellfire. But all this comes with what? Comes with consequences. There's a lot of attachments to it. I believe in Allah Azza wa Jal. Okay. Part of my belief in Allah is what? That I obey Allah Azza wa Jal. Part of my belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that I obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Part of my love to Allah Azza wa Jal is that obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, never disobey Him. That's part of my love to Allah azza wa jal. For that, my brothers and my sisters, it's so important for us to be conscious of what we say and what we do, and aim for the Jannah. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says in the hadith, إِذَا سَأَلْتُمُ اللَّهَ الْجَنَّةَ فَاسْأَلُوهُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ. If you ever ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the Jannah, ask Him for the highest level of the Jannah. Don't aim for anything low. Don't say, inshallah, I'll be in the Jannah. No, I don't want to enter the Jannah. I want to enter the highest level of the Jannah. That's what you should be aiming for. That's the character and the quality of a true mu'min. He or she don't aim for the lowest levels of the Jannah. No, I'm not aiming for the lowest level of the Jannah. I am aiming for the highest level of the Jannah. I'm aiming to be in the company of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his fellow prophets and messengers. That's what I'm aiming for. That's a true mu'min. That's a true believer. Not, ya Allah, I'll enter the hellfire. And then after a few thousands of years, after Allah Azza wa Jalla punishes me in the hellfire, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put me in the Jannah because I'm a Muslim and I say, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu Muhammad Rasulullah. MashaAllah. What kind of an aim is that? What kind of a mindset or mentality is this? No. I aim to be obedient to Allah. I aim not to even experience the hellfire, even see the hellfire, smell the hellfire, get near the hellfire. I'm aiming not only to enter the Jannah, but I'm aiming to be in the highest level of the Jannah. I'm living here for 60, 70 or 100 years or whatever it is. I'm living for this short space of time in this world, and inshallah I'm going to make the most out of it in the pleasure of Allah. Fearing Allah and having hopes in the mercy of Allah. Inshallah, we'll continue on this subject next week. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from me and you. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who listen and hear and act upon what they listen and hear.